I need to maintain, you know, what I do on a day-to-day basis pretty rigorously, because the alternative for me is not a good one. Being sober is, I don't know, it's kind of a double-edged sword. It wasn't a easy 180 turn for me. I caused a lot of pain and sleepless nights for people. You know, you still kind of feel like people are waiting for the other shoe to drop. Like, when's it going to happen again? You know, do I still need to guard my purse? Do I still need to keep things locked up? It takes a lot to get sober, and it takes a lot of introspection, a lot of self-learning, a lot of looking at what you did to cause things, not like this person did that and that made me do it. You really have to take a good hard look at yourself and what part you played in everything.
Hang on for the ride. I think I feel a change of tide. Just sit for one life. One day you're gonna be my wife. You'll never have to worry again. I'm gonna be your man. Oh, someday, when tall boys turn into champagne, when bologna turns into steak, when I can go instead of change,
is Dave Robotham, born and raised in Montclair, 35 years old, still living here, had a couple bouts in and out of Montclair, but was raised here till I was 18, went to college, came right back at 22, jumped around a little bit due to some craziness, I guess, for lack of a better word, you know, starting a family, like adult life now, I'm back in Montclair. The importance of sports, especially, like I said, growing up in a town like Montclair was, for me, it was a great thing. I loved it. My mother was from the town, so we were raised right around the corner from a woman she grew up with, one of her close friends, and she was a mother of seven. So me being from a family of four, having, you know, people who were more or less like brothers around the corner, and seven of them to play with growing up, and then another family that we got very close with, as soon as they moved into town, they were a family of three boys. You had like a full baseball team, a full football team, a full lacrosse team, or growing up around the neighborhood whenever you wanted. Being surrounded by that and surrounded by a lot of guys who excelled at sports, it made you really want to not only excel in sports, I guess, but selfishly do better than everybody else. Someone made all county, you wanted to make all state. If someone made all state, you wanted to make, you know, all American. Sports was a place where it always helped me try to fit in. And from the outside looking in, you would think that I was normal. I had friends, I did decent at school. But growing up inside, there was always something for me that I felt was like internally off. I was a little different than everyone. And I could never put my finger on it. I never knew what it was. I just knew that for some reason, like, I felt like there was something wrong with me. Like, I didn't fit in. There were no, like, red flags. There was no signs of, like, man, this kid's fucked up. Like, he needs help in some way, shape, or form. Because, like I said, I wasn't learning disabled. I wasn't lashing out in school. I was socially okay. I got along with people. I made friends. I wasn't an asshole, and I wasn't like a loner where I just, you know, wanted to be left alone. I wouldn't talk to anyone. And as far as like, you know, social things, sports and, you know, making friends, sleepovers outside of school, all that was, you know, par for the course, except again, inside, no matter what I did to try to be normal or like, well, everyone's playing sports, let's do that. Everyone's doing this, let's do that. I always felt like there was something a little bit off. So the more I felt like there was something a little bit off, the more I put into school, the more I put into athletics. I kept clawing at this feeling of normalcy or acceptance that I thought if I did really good at something, it was finally gonna like be an aha moment. all right, great, I won a state championship and I made this type of accolade, and all right, now I get it, now I fit in, now I'm normal. And it just never came. And that's something that, you know, down the road in life, I unfortunately, through a long list of mistakes, slips, fucking, some people call it hitting a bottom. I fucking hit a bottom and then took the elevator down another floor and then rolled down a fucking hill and then jumped off the fucking balcony from the basement. As I got as low as you could possibly go. And that still wasn't enough. If there was a cement floor, I would have got a little pickaxe and I would have tried to fucking keep going lower. I wanted to keep going lower. And in high school, I kept everything in check. As far as my friends went, like comparatively to my friends, I was pretty normal and responsible. But when I got to college, like I was considered a pretty heavy drinker. So I think that just showed that we did a lot of partying in high school. I was 26, 27. I had just broken up with what I thought was like the love of my life. I wasn't playing sports anymore. I just got my master's degree. Nothing was holding me back at that point. I didn't have a girlfriend that I needed to behave for. I wasn't playing a sport that I needed to worry about being hungover, out of shape for. And I had just finished the second level of school. So I thought like I was at a level of completion and I could kind of celebrate. That combining with the hurt of the end of that long-term relationship led me to drink way more often than I had been before. 3, 4, 5 nights a week. By the time that started to get to where maybe I thought I was drinking too much, and it was the summer, I was down the shore, I was, you know, only 25, probably partying more than your average person, but with alcohol, I was making good money, I was bartending, I had a very good teaching job. I was single, I had no real responsibility aside from like my student loans, but it was starting to really impede on my life. I was hungover, I was starting to get like anxiety at nights I wouldn't drink, I couldn't sleep. Being a bartender, I saw some of these guys down the road that might have been me 20 years down the road, and I was like, man, they look fucking miserable. I do not want to be that guy. And I started to have like a little fear in my stomach, like that might be me. You know, I might just be miserable and just keep pushing forward and get more miserable. I had injured my shoulder the summer of 2009, and I was prescribed painkillers. At first, I used them because I needed them, because I was teaching. I was a phys ed teacher, so I had to move, I had to throw, I had to lift stuff. It was only my second year teaching, so I knew I couldn't get the shoulder surgery that I was supposed to, because I would have been out for 6 months. I was scared of losing my job. So sometime during that fall, I remember the night specifically. I don't remember exactly what night it was, like October 13th. One of my friends was like, oh, dude, you have these? You know, if you take two, it's going to fucking knock you out. And I remember to this day, I was on the couch watching TV, took two, and it hit me like a ton of bricks. Literally like laying there floating on a cloud, like not a care in the world. All my anxiety was gone. Depression, any feeling of loneliness, all wiped out. And not only gone, but then filled with like feelings of euphoria. At that point, it like clicked, like, wow, maybe I don't need to drink all the time. I could take a night off, take two of these. I still get a little outside of myself. Honest to God, the awareness wasn't like what it is now. I was getting it from a doctor. I had originally really needed it. And then when that light switch went off, when I knew I could get fucked up on it, it was just like, phew, all bets are off. I wasn't thinking about possibly getting sick one day. I wasn't thinking about possibly turning into a drug addict. I by no means was possibly thinking about, well, I had just had a little bit of a problem with alcohol, or so I thought, maybe this isn't the best idea to be popping these all the time. But again, it was taking me away from alcohol, so I really thought I was doing something, you know, straightening out a little bit, as fucking crazy as that sounds. Switching one for the other, in my mind, that was a good idea. The pills put a fast forward on that misery that can keep you drinking for 30, 40, 50 years before you might realize this isn't what you want to do. Within months, you're physically addicted. Probably within, you know, 8 month weeks, you're mentally addicted. If you start to like it, then it is just a matter of time before you become physically addicted. If you were to ask any of my family members, any of my people that like loved me, they would probably say I had a problem within 2 years of hurting my shoulder. They knew something was off. They knew something was different about me. The farthest thing from anyone's mind was this guy has a drug problem. For the most part, I couldn't function without them. I really didn't want to get out of bed without them, either because I didn't want to mentally. I was, you know, maybe physically clean, but mentally I wasn't all there. Or more likely, I was physically addicted at the time and I couldn't function without him. And that's when I knew I really, really had a problem. My family stepped in. Unfortunately for me, when I chose to get help, I hung around the wrong people in the facilities I was trying to get help at. And not only did I continue to do what I was doing, but I learned about other ways to do it and cheaper ways and dirtier ways and more disgusting ways of doing it. Within 90 days of like the completion of my first treatment, I had crossed over from pills to heroin. Instead of spending $200 a day, I could spend $200 and it can last me 10 days. But like anything tolerance-based, you know, you quickly get back up to spending more money than you have. It doesn't become about getting high anymore. It becomes about not being sick, and it doesn't matter how much money you have because you're going to get it. You're going to steal it. You're going to sell something. You're going to steal something and sell it. You're going to lie to someone. At that point, it's the fun has been gone for a long time, whether you're ready to admit it or not. The social things that it addressed as far as anxiety, depression, loneliness, that was all gone. The remedy that it had for that, because you felt more alone now than ever. You felt like no one else understood you. No one else was going through this, while there is thousands, millions of people going through it, and you just need to open your mouth, go out and try to address the problem instead of hiding behind it. At around 29, I really knew I had a problem, but I thought I was smarter than it. And it took a lot of trial and error on my part before I really believed that no matter what shape or form the drug or the drink was in, if I continued to experiment and take them and think I could do a little bit of this, a little bit of that, my life was going to be miserable. Because it was always going to lead me back to just being out of control in some way. And I thank God I got to a point in my life where I needed to hit the brakes and say, if this keeps going, I'm going to either be dead or doing a very long prison sentence. And I don't want to be dead. And I know I'm not cut out for jail, so something's got to give. Because I'm terrified of going to jail, and I don't think I'm lucky enough to die. As crazy as that statement sounds, there was a long point in my life where it would have been easier for that to be the outcome. You know, the one thing that keeps me going and doing the next right thing is my daughter. You know, you talk to certain people and you get a certain perception of what someone that lives a sober life or sobriety is like, and this has to come first, or this has to come first. And of course, those things come first because everything goes to the wayside. If I don't take care of myself and I don't stay sober, so does that ultimately mean that I come first? In many respects, no. There's a way that I can work my schedule out where I can do what I need to do to be the best person I can be, and put my daughter first. I would say every action that I do in some way, shape, or form is relevant to, you know, being the best person I could be for my daughter.